Lasers, rainbows, the 80s, drum machines, digital, big hair. This is some righteous stuff. No kidding, the compact disc was a radical departure from how, well, really how a lot of stuff worked. You could argue that the CD, with its vast data capacity, relatively robust nature, and with the further developments it spurred along, changed how the world did virtually all media. That is, at least until physical media became the seemingly undesirable thing it is today, a time when streaming services and libraries on hard drives are all the rage. Unless, of course, it's vinyl, then by all means, please, build your collections. Wow, the snark's coming early today. Well, this is the third video in a series on digital sound. You can find a playlist to the previous two videos in which we covered how digital sound works, as well as the Nyquist-Shannon sampling theorem, but for now, sit back and relax as you feast your eyes on the silver platter that is the compact disc. No discussion of the compact disc is a good discussion unless it pays homage to its predecessor, the Laserdisc. Now, I've done a series on Laserdisc if you'd like to learn more, but in brief, this was the very first commercial optical storage format. First released in test markets in 1978, Laserdiscs were usually 12-inch or 30-centimeter discs, and they were an analog video format holding up to 1 hour of video per side. Competing in a world where the video cassette recorder, which could record from live TV, already existed, the Laserdisc failed to capture the hearts and minds of many individuals, even though it had stellar video quality. Throughout its life, it stayed a videophile-only format in most markets. But the development of the Laserdisc, which was done in large part by Philips, presented an obvious solution to the problem of digital sound storage. See, although Laserdisc is an analog format, the signals encoded on it are a series of pits and lands. Okay, optical disc fundamentals time. You might already be aware of this, but optical discs are read by shining a laser up at a reflective disc that is covered with little pits. These pits are roughly 1/4 as deep as the wavelength of laser light that will hit them. I ran into some inconsistencies regarding the exact depth of the pits, because the only source I found which specifies it has the wrong wavelength of light listed for the CD, but all you need to know is that when the focused laser hits a pit, the increased depth causes the reflected light to destructively interfere with the projected light, which reduces the overall intensity of the light reflected back. That's actually a pretty neat part that often gets overlooked. Endless articles talk about the fact that the pits change how the light is reflected, but very few mention the destructive interference aspect of it. I've shown this diagram before, and it perfectly demonstrates what happens. When the laser hits a not pit, the light gets reflected right back down to the laser, and a prism reflects some of it into the photocell. But when it hits a pit, the destructive interference greatly reduces the intensity of the reflected light, so very little light hits the photocell. This is how a laser pickup system can tell the difference between a pit and a land. In the Laserdisc system, these pits and lands were used to encode analog video and audio signals via a weird hybrid of pulse width modulation and frequency modulation. Don't ask, it's complicated. And the result is a usable analog video signal from a shiny plastic disc. So, having already invented a thing that used lasers to read information on a disc, when it came time for a digital music format to hit the scene, Philips was poised to knock it out of the park with a new disc, this one no less lasery, but quite a bit more compact. They named the format along the lines of their previous compact invention, the compact cassette, and in a non-coincidence, the diameter of the CD is roughly the same as the diagonal length of the compact cassette. Ah, but let's not forget Sony's role. Sony, the people who seem to only make either runaway successes or disastrous failures, had been working on digital audio for some time. They were the ones that developed a PCM adapter for use with U-matic video cassette recorders, as discussed in the previous video, and in fact, they were working on a digital optical audio disc before Philips released the Laserdisc. One of their early prototypes from 1977 was the same size as one of these honkers and held only an hour of digital audio, though at the same exact quality of the soon-to-be compact disc digital audio standard. Philips and Sony were sort of working on the same thing at the same time, though Philips had the notable advantage of having already developed and manufactured the Laserdisc by the time things really heated up. Still, Sony contributed a lot. I don't want to get too into the weeds of who did what, so let's just jump to 1979, the year that Sony and Philips first decided to, for realsies, collaborate on the project. By this time, optical disc fundamentals had been established. An optical disc seemed the perfect format for digital data because you could easily just call a pit a 1 and a land a 0. But that's not how it works. No, the pits and lands are important, but it is the change between a pit and a land that encodes a 1, and no change encodes a 0. This is time-based, So a 4-bit span of time which is comprised of either all pits or all lands will produce 4 0 bits. Start the sequence with a change and then continue as is, and you get 1 0 0 0. No change, change, no change, no change, and you get 0 1 0 0. And you get the idea. This is called non-return to zero inverted encoding. Now, this has limitations, because a long span of zeros requires an outside clock to keep track of how many dead spaces have passed. The longer you have between ones, or changes, the more ambiguous the number of zeros becomes. I know what you're thinking. Was that 6 zeros or only 5? Well, to tell you the truth, in all this excitement, I kinda lost track myself. Which is why you need an outside timing source, keeping track of how many shots, I mean bits, have passed. This isn't somewhere you should just feel lucky. But that's not a problem. What is a problem is the nature of everything. How likely do you think it is that a pressed CD is absolutely perfect, has no scratches at all, and that the CD player reading the disc will perfectly, without any errors, reproduce the correct sequence of ones and zeros? If you answered not likely at all, you're a winner! To help make the data less susceptible to stupid little things, two robust error-fighting mechanisms are built into the data stream. The Red Book Standard, the first of the Rainbow Books that defines the physical, digital, and other various standards surrounding each type of compact disc, not only specifies the sample rate and bit depth of the compact disc digital audio format, which as previously discussed is 44.1 kHz, 16-bit, but it also defines how the data is encoded on the disc. Now, this is rather technical, but I think interesting, so bear with me. So, each audio sample is a signed, which means it can be positive or negative, 16-bit 2's complement, which is a mathematical operation on binary numbers that we're just not going to worry about right now because it hurts my brain, integer. I mean, we know we're dealing with 16-bit audio, so each sample is going to be 16 bits. Now, on the disc, 12 samples, 6 each for the left and right channels, are stored together in a frame of 192 bits. That's 24 bytes for those playing along at home. These frames are then encoded using an error correction scheme called CIRC, which stands for Cross-Interleaved Reed-Solomon Coding. In addition to adding one data parity byte to every 3 raw data bytes, the effect of CIRC is basically to spread the data out over a longer distance. That's where the interleaving part of the name comes from. By jumbling up multiple frames and adding parity bytes, CIRC can correct up to 3,500 bits of error-filled or even missing data, and can compensate for up to 12,000 bits by masking errors via interpolation. This translates to up to 2.4 millimeter gaps in data being completely corrected for, and up to an 8.5 millimeter scrambling of data, either through a scratch or some other damage, being reasonably interpolated and masked. The end result is that the error is either completely corrected or it's fudged well enough that you won't hear it. Now we're going to go on a minor tangent here. I apologize. I've linked in the description the source material from the Wikipedia article on CIRC. This source material is from a book written by Keith Schauhammer Immink, one of the central engineers involved in the development of the compact disc. He even won an Emmy for his work on coding technology for optical recording formats. I'm bringing this up because for every person that tells you Wikipedia is a worthless starting point for research, I want you to show them the references section at the bottom of articles. Yes, you would be very unwise to cite Wikipedia in any research, but let me tell you, you may be amazed at the quality of source material, and you'd be a fool to not at least look at these references when doing any preliminary research of your own. Rant over. In addition to CIRC, the use of 8 to 14 modulation limits the total number of possible combinations of ones and zeros. EFM translates each 8-bit word into a 14-bit word. These 14-bit words are translated back into their original 8-bit words using a lookup table. The point of doing this is to reduce the possibility of errors. The use of EFM makes it such that binary ones are always separated by at least 2 zeros, and a maximum of 10 zeros. This means that every pit and land is at least 3 clock cycles long. It also means that if the CD player reads 101, it knows it must have made an error because that's not a possible sequence. Plus, with a maximum of 10 zeros, it reduces the accuracy required in the clock of the CD player for worst-case clock recovery, as there must be a 1 after every 11th bit, and this will in effect synchronize and restart the zero-counting clock. Keep in mind that with simple 8-bit recording, you could in theory have 14 zeros in a row. When you realize all of the processing that has to be done by the CD player before it can even extract the data it needs to send to the DAC and play the dang music, you gain a newfound respect for its achievements of the time. Granted, using a lookup table and performing some basic arithmetic is easy for a computer, but the fact that this was being done at a consumer hardware level in 1982 with a data throughput faster than what any contemporary microcomputer would reasonably expect it to process impresses me. To help provide logical access to the contents of the disk's data stream is divided into three parts: the lead-in, the program area, and the lead-out. The lead-in contains the disk's table of contents, which is basically an announcement to the player of how long it is, how many tracks it contains, and what the time code is for each of the tracks. The CD player can, through reading the table of contents, determine where each track is for accessing it nearly instantly. A CD can have up to 99 tracks, which themselves can be divided further into 100 indexes, though this feature was rarely ever used and few CD players could access the index information. One thing that computers have made a little confusing about the compact disc digital audio standard is that audio CDs do not contain files. If you pop one into a CD, it's going to show you each track as its own object, but the computer is interpreting that for you. In raw form, the data on a CD is just one continuous stream, and the table of contents in the lead-in simply defines where along the stream each track is. The concept of using a CD for computer data storage just wasn't really in the cards yet. I mean, a single audio track would easily fill up entire hard drives at the time, so the idea of creating files to contain the audio data was just absurd. The later CD-ROM, following the Yellow Book standard, would allow for file structures on disks like a computer is used to accessing. But we'll get to that later. Okay, so let's look a little bit closer at the disk itself. First, I want to see if you can spot a big difference between a Laserdisc and a CD. Looking at the edge of a Laserdisc, can you see that seam in the middle? Laserdiscs are obviously double-sided, so that seam is the join between the two halves of the disk, and the data is sandwiched between two sides. But if you look at the CD, there is no seam. One of the weirder things about the CD is that the data layer is actually at the top of the disc, just beneath the label. I've linked to a How It's Made episode on the compact disc that does a pretty good job of demonstrating how mass-produced discs are made. Their manufacture is surprisingly similar to that of conventional vinyl records, as they are stamped, or rather molded, from a master disc. The video does a great job of showing this process, but it skips over the actual etching of the data onto the glass master. In short, the master is covered in a solution that will either evaporate or harden when exposed to laser light, depending on the mastering process used. By using the laser to etch pits into the coating, which is then hardened with the development process, the glass master is now covered in bumps that will represent the lands in the molded discs. The master disc is metallized to harden these bumps, and now polycarbonate discs are molded from it. And that's something that I find really neat about the compact disc. The data in stamped discs is actually in the plastic itself. When the disc comes out of the mold, it's completely transparent. But it has all of the data on its surface. To make the disc readable, it's then covered in a thin film of aluminum via a vapor metallization process, and now the disc could theoretically be read by a CD player. But remember, those pits and lands are on the top of the disc, exposed. If they could be touched, the data would be destroyed. So before the disc can be handled, it needs a thin coat of varnish to be spread along the top, and now the data is protected from damage. Putting the data layer on the top of the disc meant that the disc was even more tolerant of scratches, as these scratches are out of focus to the laser reading the disc from below. This was a pretty smart move. The laser would read through almost the entire 1.2mm thickness of the CD. As a consequence, double-sided CDs were never a legitimate thing. But there were some weird shenanigans tried with making double-sided hybrid discs. One of these I have somewhere in my collection, but I couldn't find it because I'm disorganized. Sorry. Is the dual disc. Weird Al Yankovic's 12th studio album, Straight Outta Linwood, was released in 2006 as a dual disc, with one side being a fully compliant DVD containing music videos and other goodies, and the other side being a almost CD. Dual discs were 0.3 millimeters thicker than a standard CD or DVD, comprising a total thickness of 1.5 millimeters rather than the standard 1.2. The CD layer was placed 0.9 millimeters into the disc, with the DVD layer 0.6 into the disc from the other side, which is correct for a DVD, but it's off by at least 0.2 millimeters according to the Red Book standard. Because of this, dual discs did not contain the compact disc digital audio logo on them because they technically weren't CDs. They featured language saying that they were intended to work in standard CD players, and almost certainly they would, given the tolerances a standard CD player is designed to deal with, but they could not actually be officially referred to as a compact disc. So, there's some fun trivia for you. And that's where we'll hit pause. There's a lot of neat stuff to uncover about the CD, even though it's teetering on the edge of obsolete and insignificant. Okay, it is pretty much obsolete. This dime-sized SD card holds more data than this entire column of CDs. That's kinda sad, but also amazing. In my next video on the subject, we'll explore more of the innards of the compact disc, such as the optical pickup mechanisms and the rather major difference between how Philips designed its laser pickup compared to most others. If you take a look at the disc tray on this Magnavox unit, you might get a hint. Of course, we'll also touch on the other various uses of the CD, such as the CD-ROM, CD-R, and CD-RW, and other stuff. And then we'll relish in the fact that everything is on the internet now. Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed the video. If this is your first time coming across the channel and you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing. As always, thank you to everyone who supports this channel on Patreon, especially the fine folks that have been scrolling up your screen. If you're interested in making a contribution to the channel to help it grow, please check out my Patreon page. Thanks for your consideration. Don't forget, there is a Technology Connections subreddit now, so if you're a Redditor, you can go over there and watch me not know how to use it. And I'm getting better at Twitter, so if that's something you do, you can follow me at TechConnectify. Anyway, that's it for now. I'll see you next time. Cue obnoxious music! This line read better before. With its vast data capacity, relatively robust... This line is going to kill me. When it came time for digital music formats to hit the scene, Philips was poised to knock it out of the park. Poised? No, that's what I wrote. I'm regretting it now. The Red Book Standard, the first of the Rainbow Books that define the physical, digital, and other digital. Reduces the accuracy required in the clock of the CD player for which. The master disc is metalized.